So going into this record, I knew exactly what I wanted to do. I took full control over everything. I had no A&R guy. I A&R'd this record. I didn't talk to my label. I didn't talk to my management. I just said, let me do my thing. I wrote songs, recorded them, and no one heard anything till I was done. Everything that's happened to me in the past 6 months, which is writing my record, recording it, and just this whole creative process for me, has been a very natural progression. I've explored a bit and I've done different things, and I've, like, you know, from screaming in my songs to swearing in my songs to talking about limoncello, kind of rapping and doing different beats. And what's great is, like, I didn't really realize it at the time, but it's like I totally evolved and went to the next level, and that's what the fans are, like, waiting for, and they want me to be me, but I think they want new stuff, and I want to do new stuff, so I think it's the perfect mixture. I Can Do Better is my favorite song on the record, and I had the most fun working on that song. I had way too much fun, and it was just very, like, I wasn't thinking about anything. I wasn't, like, trying to make lyrics perfect or make sense. It was just, like, it was just all spur of the moment. It was just so random. Luke and I were partying in the studio, running around, skateboarding, doing this and that, and running in and out of the booth.
Basically, when we did I Can Do Better, Alvaro and I, you know, we got, I think we drank 3/4 of a bottle of in, like, within a couple hours. She drank, I think, a bottle of limoncello. And we just, you know, we were just doing shots and drinking and jumping around in the studio. Like, we were having a really good time.
So I said, you know what? I gotta write something about limoncello in this song.
That was an ollie, and you saw it, motherfucker!
Sometimes we go and skate in the parking lot because, you know, just getting away like that allows me to clear my mind.
What are we gonna do for our verse? The rest of the lyrics.
Limoncello in the verse, because
oh,
we're
shit.
Supposed
yes,
to.
Yes, 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 we're using that.
Or the bridge.
I'll drink as much limoncello as I want. As I can. There's the verse. You just caught it,
Dibble.
I will drink.
As much limoncello as I can, because it makes me happy over again.
It?
Lemon, and then C-E-L-L-O.
C-E-L-L-O-W?
No. Yeah, I think so. No W.
You're spelling it wrong!
No W. And no two M's in lemon. Yes, that's what I'm trying to say, boo!
I'll drink as much limoncello as I can, and I'll do it again and again, and, like, the way she says it, it's really fucking fun, and we were shit-faced fucking drunk, you know?
This is so funny. I will drink as much limoncello as I can, because it makes me happy again and again.
Alright, do it, motherfucker. You ready? You ready?
Get fucked.
Oh! Fucking do it. Awesome, get the fuck in here.
I'm here!
I'm back.
Woo!
That was kind of fun for me, just putting something random in a song. Because random is limoncello.
That's funny! limoncello in our song.
And we did it.
Yeah, we
No did. Questions asked. Just put the fucking thing in, put in the fucking song.
The best damn thing is just about, you know, being the shit and, you know, being a little princess and not taking crap from guys. And really different for me because the verses were kind of rappy. I hate it when a guy doesn't have it. And that was the first song I did that on.
Anything that makes you go, I don't know if I want to do that, or if it makes you, like, give you a knee-jerk reaction, do it. If you love those kind of records by other artists that do stuff like that, that are adventurous and doing crazy stuff, then do it yourself.
All right, cool. Let's roll it.
I hate it when a guy doesn't understand why a certain time a month I don't want to hold his hand. I hate it when they go out and we stay in and they come home smelling like their ex-girlfriend.
Butch is an artist. He's a really good singer, songwriter, and he's been touring for years, and he's released his own records, and he's been in a ton of bands.
That being said, I feel like I can make it a less weird experience because a lot of producers and writer guys come in and intimidate the shit out of this person right away. That's just not the way I've approached it.
Go for it, go on.
She wanted it to have this very like cheerleading anthem almost vibe and have that message that's like that focused on the strength of a woman.
Did you just burp?
Yeah.
That was insane. It sounded like a fart, but I didn't want to be like, did you just fart? I mean, I know you well, but we haven't gotten to that comfortability in our relationship yet where I can handle a fart out of you. It's like, not from my sweet little Avril. Not a fucking fart. No, okay, I can handle that. I can deal with that.
Right after recording The Best Damn Thing, I knew that song was very special because it was a new sound for me, and to me, it's a hit. Working with Derek, it was just, you know, it was nice because I like his music and I think he's really good at what he does. And the songs that I gave him were kind of along the lines of pop punk, pop rock songs.
I mean, she'd written these songs and she didn't know what she wanted to do with them, so she wanted to hear them in a somewhat completed form. So when we started out, they were just kind of demos. We never really knew if they were going to go on the record or not. They were just kind of the first batch of songs that she had.
Okay, I'm just going to have you sing.
That's when I start to realize what you bring to my life. Damn, this guy can make me smile.
The way she can make a lyric sound important or feel important or mean something, you know, it's just few artists can really do that.
So high all the time.
You sound really great, babe. Great job.
You're a candy in the end.
You sounded awesome.
Thank you. I think he's an amazing guitar player. He has great taste with the guitars, and he always has a great, really good tone, and he has such like a great style. Feels like young, but really aggressive and catchy, and I think he's really good at what he does. Steve-O from Sum 41 also played drums on those songs.
It was actually kind of easy the way we had this all set up, because I was producing the Sum 41 album already, so I was in the studio and I had all the drums set up and everything was mic'd and ready to go. Well, Steve-O and I have had this dynamic for a long time, and he kind of just knows what to put into the song just by hearing it, what the vibe is.
Derek and Avril brought me on board because I come very cheap. I work for burritos, black bean burritos.
Well, his only request was he would do it for a burrito as long as he would only, if he would get the right burrito from the right place, and it had to be a burrito, vegetarian burrito with black beans.
And I specifically said black bean burrito. The whole time we were recording, I was like, black bean burrito, make sure it's black bean. I don't want to see one pinto bean. If there's one pinto, I'm leaving. With the master reel. That's what I said. The whole record, not even the stuff I did. Just I'm leaving with the record.
Usually when I start hearing him play something, I'll have ideas for what parts he should play, and I'll just show it to him, and he picks it up so quick.
And then he goes, it does a little snare roll, and then he goes, psst. And it does like something like in a wake, like for four bars.
So let me just try it a couple times on my own, if you don't mind.
Yeah.
Steve-O is an amazing drummer, and he totally, you know, made the tracks rock. They sound amazing.
Got her done. Like that. Bam. And of course, at the end of the whole thing, the guy, you know, the runner at the studio says, hey, Steve-O, yeah, great work. You know, we got your burrito. They screwed up. It's pinto. So I did end up getting a complete pinto burrito. Unfortunately.
Did you get the master reel?
I didn't get the master reel. Apparently I don't have the authority to do that. You know.
We're abused. We're really abused. I'm so abused. You know. And I kind of like it.
Dr. Luke is my bitch. He has to do whatever I say. And that's that.
I am Avril's bitch, basically. But it's been fun. It's all in good fun. You know, Avril might, she might spit her gum at you. She might punch you in your stomach as hard as she can, like when you're not expecting it. She might, you know, pepper spray you. She might mace you.
I bought pepper spray one day, and I came into the studio, and I showed Luke, hey, I got pepper spray.
And, like, I'm just a dumbass anyway, like, you know, and I'd always been curious about that. So I was like, you know, hit me, you know?
I'm like, yeah, right, like, I'll get sued, I'm not spraying you. And he was like, spray me. I'm like, I'm not going to spray you, it's going to hurt you.
You want to just spray it on my face? I think I can take it.
Okay.
It's not that bad.
The producer is going to let me pepper spray him. Tell me when, Zippo.
Here we go. That was a direct shot. She sprayed me one time, hit me like here. Then she sprayed me another time, it hit me there. And then she got me like right there, and it just kind of went right into my eyes.
It fucking hurts. It's not crazy, though, yet.
Yeah, it's fucking bad.
That was gonna be like that for about 10 more minutes.
Okay, just lead me to the bathroom.
Can you do it?
Yeah!
Oh, shit.
He was out for about 45 minutes. His face was burning, and washed his face for like 20 minutes.
Luke, is it true you would take a bullet for me?
Yeah.
How many producers out there let their artists pepper spray them, taser them, spit gum on them, you know, like feed them 20 million shots of I've never seen it before. With men, I can get away with whatever I want.
It's not typical for most artists to be able to write and play and sing and really do all that stuff. A lot of people fake it. You know, Avril just happens to be able to write really well and have a great voice.
And now you wonder why you're the one alone.
And she plays guitar. She, you know, plays drums, she plays piano. She's super talented.
I prefer not to play on my record because I want it to be amazing. I want the guitar and all the instruments to be perfect. It depends on the song. If it's like a ballad, no. But like, I can do better. The guitar is so whatever. It's laid back.
Cool, let's record.
I don't know, I mean, she's good with melody, she's good with lyrics, she's good conceptualist. I think a lot of that stems from just singing and knowing what a good melody sounds like, you know, intrinsically.
Coming up with melodies for me is so easy because I've been singing so long. I've been singing my entire life, you know, performing on stage since I was 7.
You know, when she's on, it's fucking on, man. Ideas are flying, you know? I think the melodies are super strong. I think a lot of lyrics are really good. And I think it's, you know, I think it's going to be a great record.
That was dope. You just got to see Avril Lavigne in action. Fucking writing some crazy shit. You just got to see. She's really fucking good. Just comes in and does it.
Innocence is such a beautiful song to me. The song is about capturing a moment, like, of absolute bliss, a moment that's, like, perfect.
I knew the minute we wrote it, I'm like, this is a big, huge ballad. But I was really worried, because I knew if it wasn't done right, it would fucking suck. You know, I think Rob is such a good producer that he saw that her and I had a really big idea of how we wanted it to go, so he, like, very controllingly let us carry out our vision.
Like, the first couple days working with Rob was, like, really serious. And then I was like, fuck it. Let's get some.
I think she was right, though. The one day where it was, like, day number two, and we were still getting to know each other, and she was like, we're going to drink. And I was like, oh, really? Okay.
You know, everybody in the world's going to want to become a record producer after they see this.
Hey, that guy's working right now.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's looking out for you.
Again. Are we bottoming up again?
What? Yeah.
If I do that, then
on the bridge. And this is the time when I'd totally taken over Oceanway Studios.
We're going to Oh. Let's go get JJP.
There's three studios there. I had one studio with Rob Cavallo. Luke was over in the other studio, and in the middle studio, there was Jack Joseph Puig, JJP.
Knock, knock.
And we're like, drink, drink, and he's like doing a mix. Wasted talking to him, and then we ran over to Luke's studio, I'm playing Cavallo the new songs, and we just rocked out listening to my music, and then it just like came as one great big party.
You have to suffer for your art, so you have to do certain things to change your headspace. And not that getting drunk with Avril Lavigne is suffering, it's certainly not, but it's one of those things you do, you know. We went in and cut the song, and we thought it should rock a little more and have a different kind of emotions. And then, on hindsight, she realized that that wasn't really quite the right direction for the song.
I knew that the song could have a certain feel, like just sitting alone in a room, playing the song and singing it, I would get this feeling, and I didn't get it on the original recording.
It takes a lot of guts to do that, you know, artistically, because usually your first instinct is the right one. But I think in her case, she's looking for something more and to try to get something that's even a little deeper. So we came back and sort of retooled the song in a slightly different, with a different emotion, which actually was better for the lyric and for the melody.
When you're recording a song, it doesn't really matter the parts. It's all about the emotion.
I'm glad that I changed it. I knew I'd be happier with it slower and a little more laid back. It's amazing, and I'm really happy with it. I love crazy strings. I love it when strings get all busy, like Iris. So when I went into the studio and heard the strings, I almost started to cry because they moved me.
Well, I've done streaming arrangements almost exclusively with David Campbell because it's almost like the instrument that you're hiring him to play is the orchestra.
That part is cool.
That's cool, isn't it?
You know, sometimes I'll hear things and, you know, with it being my song, I have my vision for the song. Sometimes I come in and say, you know what, maybe we can do it more like this or take this out or I like this part, I don't like this part, and so I got to like work with David Campbell on the strings, and he was really cool about that.
Are your bars number in the same?
Yeah.
All right, so we're just gonna add 4 bars to this song.
The first job is to analyze it and make sure that the artist is actually bettering the song and give you a real opinion. If it is better, then yeah, go for it. In this case, of course, it was a great idea.
Oh yeah, no, we wanna go join at 53.
What do you think? Do you think that we should go right? Finish it, or do you think that we should put this in after we do it twice?
I think that's good. I like that part.
Yes,
because there's a lot of counter.
If we're gonna keep this in. Okay, we'll do that twice.
When the track got like, you know, 90%, 95% there, she was like, okay, I'm ready to sing on it. and she just does like two or three takes at the most, and they're perfect.
We're recording Innocence with Rob Cavallo, but Luke is joining us.
I'm doing nothing. I'm just watching.
You're coming for support.
I'm here for support.
La la la. Waking up, I see that everything is okay. The first time I feel loving, it's so great.
There was always a thing that she was fighting for during the process of making the track, so that, or the music, I should say, so that when she came in to sing that vocal, it was going to support all the things that she had in her mind that she was going to do as a singer, which you can't really communicate until you actually do it.
This is the best feeling. This innocence is brilliant. I hope that it will stay. This moment is perfect. And please don't go away.
And we all look around the room and we're like, "That I think that was perfect." I mean, that's it. We don't have to auto-tune. We don't have to chop it up. It's fucking weird.
Pass you by. Dude, I'm so hammered. Yeah! Woo!
Then you realize that she actually has like a very unique and very complete vision for what she's going after. And you can hear that because the vocal became so much higher a performance. It took the song so much higher. All the backgrounds and all the parts that she came up with and the different tones in her voice and how she emoted was just magical.
To be honest, Girlfriend for me was so much fun, and it was so like bitchy and in your face. I didn't think, like the second we were writing it, I didn't think that this would be my first single. I just thought it was like so out there. But then I realized, like anytime we came back to the studio to hear it, like I was so excited, like laughing. I thought the song was so funny. And then I played it for my friends, and then everyone was like, "Oh my God, that's so cool." And I only had the chorus. There was no verse or anything. We started that song just like, you know, these rocky chords in the chorus. And then I come into the studio and he's got this beat on it, and I'm just like, "Oh my God. Oh my God. Like, you totally have to do it. It sounds great like that."
The beauty of working with Avril is that she seems to really have a good idea of what she needs to do. She really knows, like, she's super aware, I think, of her audience, like what she needs to do, what she needs to say. She has good style, you know, like just, you know, she has good style and a good aesthetic sense of what she needs to do, which is unusual. It really is.
And the other cool thing was we went in there, Luke and I, and we did the clap, the hand claps, and it's like, on the bridge, that. In a second, you'll be wrapped around my finger, because I can on that part. And then in the track, we're like laughing hysterically. You can hear, like on the record, us laughing.
It's kind of embarrassing.
If you listen closely, we're like, like you hear us like giggling, but chances are, if you think it sounds like a girl, it's actually Luke's voice. He sounds like a girl laughing. And so every time I hear the bridge in Girlfriend, I want to pee my pants. It's so funny.
Great music is never perfect. And I actually have this theory, like in songs, like I always want one wrong note, like something off, like something.
Oh, yeah. And then the cool thing on Girlfriend was I was standing in the booth drinking beer, and then I started going, whoo, whoo, and blowing into the beer bottle.
It's in the
case. Hey, hey, hey. Oh my god, can we record it?
Get in there.
Let's go. Fucking beer going in the track. We just have this stuff happen. It just happens.
It was like, I drank a certain amount and it was like D or whatever. It started, it was like in tune with the track, so I started recording. Oh my god, I fucking go in there and listen to this. Go, ah, bro. I didn't think it'd be 3 p.m. All the like really good songs are always come immediately, like I'll be singing the melody and as it's coming out of me, the words will come out, and that's what happened on Girlfriend. It was like I just started kind of singing like, I don't like your girlfriend. I think you need a new one. It all just came together really fast, and it was like the end of the night, and the chorus took 2 minutes. We kept the original vocals because there was just like an energy there. No way, no way, hey! I'm a huge fan of Travis Barker's drum playing, and I've always thought, yeah, it'd be really cool to have like Travis play on, you know, on one of my songs, on my record. I brought it up to Luke, and he had already been thinking about it too, I think.
Avril really loves Blink-182, it's a band she really likes, and I just thought, fuck, we're all in LA. Why not ask, you know? I also asked David Grohl. He was busy at the time. But I actually believe that Travis was better. Certainly is the right choice for this song. Travis really didn't have any prep time. Like, he, you know, hadn't heard the songs before. In fact, he came into it as cold as we did.
I was really impressed by Travis because he only listened to the tracks like once and he got it right off the bat.
So kind of like where the times are ending up right now, where the rides and where the crashes are going, kind of like follow that same
or
what I would normally
yeah,
do.
I mean, okay. You know, if you want to go to the crash ride sooner instead of Slash Syed.
What about
you know?
The beginning, like how the intro starts off with Tom's?
Yeah.
Stay like that? Okay, it's cool.
Travis Barker has like his own unique style. He clearly comes from a punk rock background. He'll just like totally nail a song. He only has to do it once and he'll get the whole thing.
I'll put you out of the chorus this time, okay? Because I think that would get you in the vibe. We'll be right back. I was really impressed with his creativity. It's hard in any instrument to be good at an instrument. And it's about 10 times harder to have your own voice. Certainly within 30 seconds, maybe sooner, you know it's Travis Barker.
So yeah, so let's just do one where we punch you in for the first pre-chorus, and then just come in, and then I guess maybe do one where you do whatever the fuck you want, and then we're done.
Yeah, it'd be cool if you just did, like, one last take where you just go, like, crazy. Just so we have a million things if we want to add them.
Okay. You hear that?
He brought energy and he brought his personality into them, and he just killed it, you know. And I think Avril was happy. We all had fun, and I think it translates.
Hands down, this is the best record I've ever made. I had so much fun. Too much fun sometimes. I worked with Evan Taubenfeld, worked with Butch Walker, Derek Wibley, Rob Cavallo, and Dr. Luke.
I feel like in general, her record is a next evolution. I think she's taken what I have and molded it into what she needed and what she wants, and I think I've also helped her get some of the things that she wanted to do, get them out and make those a reality.
It's all about her voice, and that's where her character comes from, and I think that's why so many people believe in her music and buy into her as an artist, because everything comes through in her voice.
Whether you like her, hate her, whether you fucking hate her music, love her music, it doesn't matter, because like as soon as you hear the voice on the radio, you know it's her. And the coolest part about it is that since 5 years ago, every fucking girl tries to sound like her, and they don't.
Do what you've always dreamed of when you listen to these other records that get you excited, because they have elements like that on it. That's the most important thing, is her not being scared to try new things.
I love that she has no problem speaking her mind. I think that's the mark of a great artist. You know, she knows what she wants, and she's fearless in going about getting it. And then when it's her turn to sort of back it up and be on the hot seat and go in and perform a vocal or make a comment or whatever it is, she's awesome. There's a reason why she's that successful and why she sold so many records.
It's like one big happy family, and the songs are so much fun, and I've grown, and it's really like light, funny, kind of humorous record, like bratty, cocky, playful, just very like me. It's a good time. It's gonna be great live. I had the best time on this record, and it's called The Best Damn Thing.